and say, irrespective of what political party we are, that's the message that should go out from Democrats, from pragmatic, sensible people, that we deserve the right to have another democratic say and a vote on what we know will be the damage done to this country.
We're going to vote on the amendment. All in favour? All against? Any abstentions? No. Okay, 2-4, 83 against, it's lost. We're going to the second amendment. Can I inform everybody that this is Ms. Storey's first speech? So, Ms.
Thank you. My Lord Mayor, thank you for allowing me to make my maiden speech as a City Councillor chamber today. I've sat in this chamber before, but as a councillor in the 1980s, which is rather a long time ago. Liverpool and the City Region have a lot to thank the EU for. European Objective 1 status helped turn the city and region around. From the start, let me make it clear this is not a wrecking amendment. We support everything that is in Mayor Anderson's motion, but we seek to bolster and complement what has already been proposed. I'm particularly pleased to be able to move this amendment today because it gives me an opportunity to thank Louise Elman, Luciana Berger, Maria Eagle. The three MPs put Liverpool first by voting for motions which would keep the UK in the EU, the single market, the customs union, and had supported the concept of a people's vote on Brexit. It has become increasingly clear over the last few months how desperate the Brexit situation is becoming. The inability of the government to agree on a definite, coherent plan, the recent developments regarding the overspending of the Leave campaign, have really brought home how difficult this whole process has been for the country. It is essential we are proactive in order to prepare our city for all eventualities. Merseyside has already begun to bear the brunt of the political climate of uncertainty. Jobs have been lost in Ellesmere Port and Harewood in the automotive industry, and more jobs going in supply chain pertaining to this industry. It has also been made clear that investment in such areas may move to the continent. This will have a devastating effect on our city, as employment prospects will be affected even further. If we were to remain in the EU, which we very much hope we will, we will still need to take action in order to preserve and expand jobs in the city region. That is why we're suggesting that the Liverpool City Region office in Brussels, which is currently composed of two people, be expanded to be representative of local and regional government, our universities and our commercial and industrial sectors. We want to bring key economic players from across the city together in order to face the uncertainty created by Brexit in a proactive way. This amendment would provide an opportunity for our city to work out which sectors are most in danger, to identify any potential opportunities that may present themselves, and be prepared for an economic emergency. My Lord Mayor, this amendment is moved in a positive, not a point-scoring way. This issue is important, or too important, for political party politics. We hope the council will unite together to add this amendment to the admirable motion moved by the elected mayor, and that together we can fight both for our place in Europe and for the jobs that this city region so badly needs. Thank you.
Let me remind everyone that the referendum that took place 2 years ago to shift, so you are allowed to change your mind. The first referendum I remember well in 1974, because I was the Liberals, we were then co-chair of it. I worked alongside a Labour co-chair, a Conservative co-chair, because they were in the city, and we actually got the city voting, as it did nationally, more than 2/3 to 1/3 in favour of remaining what was then the European Community. Let me remind Council also precisely what the vote actually was 2 years ago. We work in a parliamentary democracy, a democracy in which we allow members of Parliament, of course, with supplementary scrutiny work by the House of Lords, to make decisions on our behalf. The bill that introduced the referendum was quite clear on that. The referendum was an advisory referendum which had to be referred back to Parliament. If you doubt the view of a politician on that, I can remind you that that went to the Supreme Court, which actually made that ruling. And that's why our only disagreement with the Mayor today is that at the end of the day, this comes back to members of Parliament to resolve. It's been a privilege for me, representing my party, to share platforms with the three MPs that Councillor Storey has mentioned, but also with MEPs like Theresa Griffin. We have worked across party, we've worked across party solidly, because we know, for example, that that hired Irish border isn't something over there, it's something that will start less than half a mile here in the docks in Birkenhead. We know that jobs are already being lost in Jaguar Land Rover, and there's someone here who's already left JLR early because of that, and jobs have been lost in Ellesmere. But this now comes back to Parliament. And Parliament has ducked out on two occasions now of going for the people's vote that the Mayor and I agree needs to be held.
Councillor
Kemp, you've got a minute. Yes, I've just come to the conclusion on that. The Green MP, Caroline Lucas, has always voted for this. We have. But there is a fundamental split in the Parliamentary Labour Party. This isn't seeking to exploit that split, but it's seeking to say to every one of you who's in it, get them to back the example of the three women MPs, and for example, get Dan Carden and Stephen Twigg behind this amendment. That's what you need, not us. We need to be converting those people. While Lord Mayor's Lord Storey has said, we, if you defeat this, will vote unitedly for the main resolution. But we think we're adding to the motion today by drawing Council's attention to the parliamentary nature of this and saying that irrespective of when we leave the EU, we've already lost lots of jobs because of this debate, and we need to get on with the job of finding new ones and preserving the ones that we've got. My Lord Mayor, thank you.
Any other speakers?
Just briefly, we won't accept the amendment. Comments, most of the comments, fine. You know, this is about winning the debate and winning the arguments. And I think people are doing that. People are winning the debate and the arguments. To single out a group of MPs in the city is divisive. And so actually, as Councillor Bradford tried to do, is attack the leader of the Labour Party. Is it wrong to do? It is. He talked about it. The reason why he demanded what he wanted or asked for was quite simply to try to balance open and protect jobs and look at it. That's why he argued. He argued for retention of the single market, all of those things. They're not on the table now. The thing has shifted fundamentally in the last few days, in the last 10 days.
so drastically that we are in the most serious precarious position for this country. I think it's the most challenging issue that faces this country that it's ever faced in terms of economic prosperity, jobs, all of the things that we value. They're going to go out the window. And I'm not, that's not scaring me, but it's facts. Facts. You know, we talk about taking a Land Rover, we talk about any of the car manufacturers, the biosciences, Council Grant talks about universities. That they're facts. That's from the industries themselves, from the universities. The NHS can't even cope with the demand. Now, just imagine what's going to happen to the NHS because we can't recruit staff and people. So, bottom line is, the thing has changed dramatically in the last 10 days. That's why, you know, we won't toy about with that. We've got to try and unite as many people as we possibly can around the motion. And that's why the motion stands on its own rightly. And I'd urge everyone to support it and then take this to other organisations, other councils, other cities, and get them all to fight for the same thing, that is finding an opportunity for people to have a say.
Thank you. A vote on the amendment. All in favour of the amendment? All against? Any extensions? Seven, four, 62 against, no abstentions. It's lost. We'll go to the main motion now.
It's becoming increasingly clear that the public voted 2 years ago on a false premise. First of all, we learned day by day about the breaches of trust of the Leave campaign. The electoral law broken in terms of expenses. Funded, funneled from probably Russia through the back door of Northern Ireland parties where there doesn't have to be full disclosure. Lies told to the public about imminent accession of Turkey, 20 million people coming to this country. We were promised, as a public, from the Leave campaign, that making a free trade agreement with the European Union would be the easiest deal in history. Where is it? Nowhere to be seen. We were promised by the Leave campaign there'd be an extra £350 million coming to fund the NHS. What's the reality? Billions of pounds to settle our account before we leave, 10% fall in the pound, 2% reduction in GDP already, and that's before we've even left. We know full well, not just because it's what the Remain camp say, but because it's what the government's own estimates show, that this country will be financially worse off, not better off as a result of leaving the European Union. And our health service will bear the financial cost, and as the Mayor rightly indicated, will be unable to source doctors, care assistants and nurses from the European Union in the same way if we proceed to break down speed towards going off a cliff. Let's be absolutely clear. If the public vote again to stay in the to leave the European Union, I will accept that. But what I will say to this council is, it is incumbent on us to say to the public, don't vote now on fantasy Brexit that you were presented 2 years ago. You don't need to speculate about what it is you're voting on. You now know what the offer is. If you vote again, we will know full well that we're crashing out of the European Union. We will be unable to maintain our just-in-time manufacturing. We will lose access to the biggest market that we have, 40% we will lose the ability to utilise the 62 free trade agreements, 63 after today with Japan, the third largest economy in the world. We will be throwing ourselves the concept of global Britain, of course, is loved by Donald Trump because, as his trade embargo, trade ambassador concealed, revealed a few weeks ago, they think they can screw Britain because we are on our knees and in a weak negotiating position. Donald Trump is currently trying to bring down the World Trade Organization, refusing to appoint new appeal judges to the appellate body of the WTO in order to gum up the process. Let's be clear. The world that he wants us to be up against the United States in relation to is a world where might is right and that the rule of law is gone. Lord Mayor, the essence of democracy is the public have the right to change their minds. Give them the real choice, let them choose between real Brexit, not fantasy Brexit, give them their second life.
Thank you.
I'll be quick, Lord Mayor. Just to say, Mayor Anderson's absolutely right, this is the worst political crisis this country faced in my lifetime. I do feel we've been led down a disastrous path. This motion is broadly in line with Green Party policy, so we'll be supporting it.
So, we'll go straight on. Right, we'll go straight to the vote. All in favour of the main motion?
Insofar as there is any loss from the current collapse of Carillion. But our local contractors are also bearing the price, because many of them are suddenly finding themselves unpaid from huge amounts of work that they and their staff have done, driven to the edge of insolvency, and unable to guarantee that they can continue to perform, even though the liquidators are promising to make payment for further work, just because they know they can't meet the liabilities that they've already incurred to their staff and their own subcontractors. We face the risk of a complex administration and liquidation that can take years to unpick. During the financial crisis, it took years for many of the liquidations of the financial banks and hedge funds to unravel and for the replacement to be put in place. We cannot afford to wait in this city years for the financial and legal unpicking of the liquidation of Carillion. If the government does not step in quickly, we will find ourselves with a vacant site with little work going on, deterioration of it in aspects where it's currently unfinished, and ultimately the existing Royal Liverpool site, where they have elements of masonry and maintenance which make parts of it unsafe on occasions and a rising cost, that the viability of that organisation potentially put in risk. We must now, as a city, stand together and refuse to accept the continued delay, the continued stasis, the continued washing its hands of its ultimate responsibility that the government is currently undertaking in relation to the Royal Hospital. The government commissioned this hospital. The government knew the risks it was entering into. The government must step in to make sure our local contractors are protected and that they are fully paid, and that most importantly, that the remaining 10% of work on the site is carried out quickly, so that a desperately needed new facility in the city can come on stream immediately. Because if we do not get the hospital finished by the autumn, there is no way in which a handover to a new hospital will take place over the period of winter pressures. We could easily lose a further 1, 2, or possibly 3 years if the government continues to stand back and wash its hands of this particular crisis. Our city deserves the best, it deserves better, and frankly, the Secretary of State for Health and Care and Social Care, the newly appointed Matt Hancock, should take this up as his most urgent priority and make sure that the interests of the residents of our city are put first.
Just to give things that it's important that we write this in 19, so often is the case that when we bring motions and we ask the council or me or the chief executive to write on behalf of the council, often it's done in a way that it's also suggested. Councillor Brand is absolutely right that this has got to be stepped up. This has got to be stepped up by every party in this chamber to unite behind what is an inexcusable position that we find ourselves in. I've written and I've challenged really loudly, meetings, one-to-one meetings, but written to Secretary of State, who's now changed, it's gone to Mass Hancock, but I've got an agreement that the previous the minister was coming to visit us to talk about a particular issue, because the real issue here, and again, I think it's important, and I'm more than happy to facilitate this. If the opposition leaders and yourself demand a meeting with Aidan Keogh, and I'm sure we won't need to demand, we'll have that meeting with him, because I can tell you that there's 90 million borrowed from the European Bank. 90 million that's been given by government, 90 million that's been pulled together by institutions like private sector institutions, insurance companies to bring up 90 million, and about 30 million. Again, that's tied into a contract. But the reality is that 350 million that's been earmarked for the development has not been paid. It's not been paid. But I'm led to believe that the
the problems that the build faces to put right the mess that Carillion has created is going to be somewhere between 50 and 100 million, if not more. So we're talking about not just a 12-month delay, another 12-month delay, but potentially talking about 2 years, because they've all gone on holiday, I think, today, when we see them again, or whatever, I demand that they meet before the recess, and we haven't got one because of the resignations over Brexit. But we don't know yet how the situation with the structural problems that are existing in the current developments are going to be put right. Who's going to pay for it? What are the costs? The government is saying, we gave 90 million, that's our commitment. The European Bank is saying, well, we need a business case or whatever before we give any money. And so are the private institutions. So we're in the doldrums. We're just basically paused with what is a building that is lit up at night, but nothing going on or nothing happening around it. And it's not acceptable for us as a city to actually put up with it. And so personally, myself, it is a real question of what we can do, because writing to the government on behalf of the whole council is absolutely fine, and we can do that. But I think we've got to, get discussions through our own party structures and mechanisms to see what more we can do to drive at least getting a conversation with them. Because at the minute, I've got no confidence that this government is even waking up to the fact of the problems, that they don't realise the scale of the problems that Killian has left. So that is, sorry to report that, but that is the facts as I know them, to meet with Aidan Keogh, and I'm more than happy to facilitate a discussion with him and the leaders to actually then all of us, demand a meeting. Because it's not, Labour Party members, it's everybody's whatever support and whatever that new facility, so we should ask at least to demand action and at least some movement on it, because we can't just allow it to continue.
Thank you for that.
Just respond.
No, Councillor Lee wants to, and I'll let you respond. Councillor Lee.
Thank you. Just to support the Mayor's comments and also to support the agency voiced by Councillor Grant, just on an advisory point, a technical point, a large part of the pipeway infrastructure of the hospital is constructed of carbon steel pipeline. And if carbon steel is allowed, filled with standing water and allowed to stand, it will corrode very, very quickly. The chilled water and heating services within the hospital are constructed of carbon steel. And if that decay begins, it can't be stopped, and will represent a further cost in relation to the rebuilding or the reconstruction of the hospital later on. So please be advised that your call for urgency is really well placed, because there is in fact a fair and hidden danger within the building itself.
Thank you, Honourable Mayor. We haven't intended to speak on this because the motion that's put forward by Councillor Grant is eminently sensible, and everyone should support it. I just do two things. First of all, to respond to what Councillor Labour said, any building is built to be built, not half built. And there are no halfway measures. You either finish it, or depending how long this goes on, you might have to knock it down and start again, and that money will be wasted. Particularly to respond to the Mayor, if there is anything that any of us can do using the other contacts we've got anywhere, then I think it's beholden on all of us to work with the Mayor on these issues. So if there are things that I can use in my contacts, things I do in London, let us know, so we'd be happy to be involved in any of those discussions and activities.
Well said. We can go to the vote now. Okay. All in favour of the motion? Any against? Unanimous. I some place in preschool, feeding for our most vulnerable children, by Councillor Harry Doyle. And can I inform people this is Councillor Doyle's first speech, so can we get some respect, please? Thank you.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. Back in 2007, when I was elsewhere due to an accident which for our family was great financial pressure, one morning I got ready for school. As I left the house, I picked up £1.60 for my change plate, £1.40 for the bus fare return, 20 pence toast. I got to the bus stop, got on the bus, gave the 70 pence, and that morning it was actually gone 75 pence, so I had to get the extra. So, therefore, missed my toast. But I'm telling you a little memory just because I was extremely lucky. Even though I had to miss the most important meal of the day, at least I had my free school meal. I'm proud to stand here today and tell you that, because if it wasn't for the support that I had in Labour government at the time, who knows where I'd be now. We had that support back in 2007. Now, the level of poverty in our communities is incomparable, and support is being slashed from central government. As of April this year, families on universal credit earning above the £7,400 threshold are no longer eligible to claim for free school meals. And whilst no protections in place for those who are eligible beforehand, this will have devastating consequences for our future generation. Is it fair that a family earning above this threshold who claims after the 1st of April deadline will not be in the receipt of a free school meal? Is it fair that in some cases a family with two children at different stages in their education will have access to a free school meal for one child but not the other? For the past 4 years, colleagues know I've been trained to be a primary school teacher. And in that time, I've seen the devastating impact firsthand of cuts from central government, both on schools and on local families. One thing that teachers will tell you is that schools aren't just schools anymore. They're a community, they're at the heart of the community, and when the community suffers, so does its schools and its staff. Some of you will be familiar with Maslow, Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Essentially, we'll go through the ins and outs, but in order for a child to reach their full potential, they've got to have their basic needs met first. And those basic needs include the need to feel warm, to feel safe and secure, to have access to water, and for the very reason for this motion today, access to food. This is just another example of this policy that the government is hell-bent on destroying any hope for our children to thrive and have an even chance at life. If they haven't made the lives of families up and down the country tough enough already, they want to tip them over the edge by making them pay for their children's school meals too. My Lord Mayor, my final placement in a local school this year, I had a parent come to me in tears. We just handed out the letters explaining the new law. This was a parent we supported before Christmas with a hamper, and she just earned above that threshold, and the child's moving on to a new stage in education. She won't be eligible for a free school meal next year. And that's just the impact on individual families. Think about schools as well. Schools currently receive pupil premium, and pupil premium is based on the number of people eligible for free school meals within that school. And I met with two schools in my ward last week, two secondary schools, who are hugely concerned about the impact of this policy, because currently they use that pupil premium to support local families by giving school uniforms to those that need it, paying for sanitary products for girls who've got nowhere else to turn for help. You know, I could stand here and put statistics galore on the level of impact, but I won't. I won't because to me and to the families, children are so much more than a number on a sheet. They are the lifeblood of our society, and as a teacher, they bring me joy, laughter, love, and give me hope for the future. They need nurturing and they need our help. When they grow up, when the government strips away the carpet from underneath their feet, they'll ask of our politicians, what did you do for me? And this isn't just about free food. When this government takes food out of our children's mouths, they take away their dreams, aspirations and any hope too. My Lord Mayor, our children deserve nothing but the best. and they deserve a chance, a fair crack of it at life, just like the chance I had, the support that I had. They need you, me, and everybody in this chamber to stand up to this cold and calculating Prime Minister and simply say, hands off their free school meals. Thank you.
Four speakers. Now, I want this to be brief, but I also want, if anybody spoke, or not to repeat what somebody else speaking, because this young man's just made a very good speech here, and what's left to take away from his speech in this chamber. So I'm going to take on Barbara, Jane, Liz, and Lynette.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Firstly, I just have to say congrats to Councillor Harry Doyle on an excellent maiden speech. I'm really proud of the fact that Harry is an outstanding teacher, but he's, I think, showing he may also be an outstanding councillor. He has correctly identified the impact of changes to entitlement to free school meals will reduce pupil premium in our schools, and you know, some of our schools have 75-80% of pupils on free school meals, so we're talking about a large portion of budget which really helps to close the gap and works to make those places more able to support children. As cabinet member, I'd just like to say it's worth noting that universal credit has been rolled back from 2022 to 2023, and that's not surprising. This keeps getting rolled back because it's not really a very good system, but we still have to deal with what has been proposed and the changes in May. To mitigate this, as a council, we have developed new letters to notify new claimants that their children are entitled to free school meals and will continue to be entitled through to 2023. The Revenues and Benefits Service provides schools with a weekly list of those children who are entitled to free school meals. This list is currently being updated to reflect the changes. The schools have been issued with communication bulletins providing details of the changes and the transitional arrangements that are in place until 2023. In Liverpool, we currently have around 16,000 children in receipt of free school meals, and the transitional arrangements provide a unique opportunity for the council to maximise the take-up of the free school meal offer, thereby helping many vulnerable families to claim through to that year. At the same time, it will also help schools with their pupil premium budget. Finally, we will work closely with children's services and schools to encourage the take-up through a dedicated and targeted campaign, which will include information packs for parents and nurseries, promotion sessions in schools, and targeted corporate publicity. Of course, details of the outcomes will be reported to members on a regular basis. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Councillor Corbyn.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I just publicly say well done to Joe and a big thank you, to be honest with you, because if we haven't had Joe as Mayor in horrendous times, we wouldn't have been able to respond to the level of poverty we've got across the city. And it's not only those backgrounds, it's not only those background and upbringing that does it, it's actually his heart and soul that does it, and he's absolutely determined to get this sorted. If you talk to other councils or the local authorities across the country, there's very, very few that are doing A, the amount of the wage and linked up, but also the amount of money that is pouring into people from our coffers that we can't afford, but we will determinedly afford. Just so people know, as well as to remind people, Not only have we got the citizen support scheme, which is our local welfare scheme, which is much the best in the whole of the country, we've proven that. We've also now got the Merrill Hardship Fund, which is pouring money directly for those who aren't quite hitting the citizen support scheme. And Harry mentioned the basic needs, the basic needs from Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which we've updated. We've got the digital access in there, and we've got lots of other things in there that actually make sense, including clothing and period quantities in there as well. And we're the only council in the whole of the country to do a cumulative impact assessment. Because if we remember, this isn't just free school meals we're talking about, this is the complete link up with all of the things that are crashing around whole families and whole communities. And we're now getting to the stage where normally families, I can think of loads of families in the North End who weather the storm, they are now cracking as a family network, and that's what's really, really dangerous. And we need a new government very, very quickly. We need a Labour government because they're the ones that care. And also, just thinking back to yesterday, out of the 10 new cases that I got for surgery yesterday, 10 of them, were people who literally hadn't got a penny in their pocket. So I was able to then refer them through very quickly. We could get money to them, we could get food to them, we could get white goods, we could get beds. And I think the thing about Liverpool is that yes, we are an incredibly resilient city, and we will carry on being resilient, and we will carry on looking out for each other. But there comes a point where whole chunks of the city's whole structure is literally falling off, and that is purely down to Theresa May and her government.
While Margaret Thatcher was the milk snatcher, Theresa May is doing something far more damaging. She is literally taking the food out of our children's mouths. This council estimates that 25,000 children will be affected by this Victorian policy. The Labour Council will not allow this to happen in our city. For some children, a free school meal is the most substantial meal of the day. This policy will result in parents making choices such as feeding their children or paying bills, choices no parent should have to make. It not only creating food poverty, but it literally doesn't make sense in terms of health or economics. Free school meals are key to giving children a nutritious diet, contributing positively to children's health and their academic achievement. The government's policy is not just morally wrong, it doesn't make sense. In 2018, with the biggest economy, we cannot stand by and allow this government to take away healthy meals from hungry children already hit by poverty. I urge our mayor to continue to fight with the children, all the children of our city, and let this government know the terrible impact this policy will have on our children.
That was your first speech. I do apologise, it's not time. Slap me up there. Okay. Councillor O'Brien.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. As many of you may know, I did teach for 22 years, and the amount of anecdotal evidence amongst teachers about the effect of poor diets and low breakfasts on academic attainment was a constant subject of conversation in Scarborough. Personally, I don't really think that we should not be taking away any school meals. I think we should be offering free